All right, thank you. Bless you. You can be seated. Appreciate all you that stood up. The rest of you, I have spies looking. No. It is really great to get to be back with you again this morning. Appreciate you guys coming back. How many of you were here last night? Okay, almost everybody, maybe everybody. That's awesome. Excited about what I want to share this morning, both from, on a personal level, but also as importantly on a corporate level, because how many know God has an agenda in the earth? The kingdoms of this world shall become the kingdoms of our Lord and of His Christ, and He shall reign forever and ever. Amen. And the Bible says that Jesus is sitting at the right hand of the Father in Hebrews 10:13, waiting until His enemies be made His footstool. So if He's waiting, that means He has given us an assignment to work together with Him and all that He has already done to actually subdue the enemies that are resisting the kingdom reign of God from coming. He's sitting at the right hand waiting. Everybody say waiting. That means that there are things that we as His ecclesia, His governmental, judicial, legislative body, there's things that we are called to do and that we must do for the purposes of the kingdom to be seen and to be done. And so it's quite an honor that the Lord has given us to work together with Him. Amen. And so let me just show you a scripture here before I go into teaching. Last night we talked about the accuser and the courts of heaven and how he's a complainant at law and all these kind of things. Let me show you something of what happens when we answer the accusations in the courts. And so in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 10, when we go into the courts of heaven and we answer the accusations of the devil, and I'm springboarding off what I said last night, so if you happen to not be here, just listen carefully, maybe you'll catch up. That when we go into the courts of heaven and answer the accusations that the enemy is using to resist God's kingdom will to be done, watch what happens. Revelation 12 and verse 10, it says, "Then I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of His Christ have come." Watch this. "For the accuser of the brethren who accused them before God day and night has been cast down." And then it says, "And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, the word of the testimony, and they did not love their lives unto death." But notice what happens when the accuser is cast down, when he is silenced. It says, "Salvation, strength, and the kingdom of God and the power of His Christ have come." That's what happens. You see, what is resisting salvation and the power of His kingdom and the power of His Christ from being made manifest? The accusations of the devil. Because the moment we answer those accusations in the court of heaven, the moment we do, there will be a manifestation and a demonstration of the kingdom. Any lack of the demonstration of the kingdom in our midst that we desire, that we long for, is because the enemy has a legal right to resist us, and therefore what God intends to do cannot be done because we are not granting him the legal right as judge by being a part of silencing the accuser so that his Father's heart and Father's passion can be made manifest. Does that make sense to you? So I love when I read it, I think when the accuser is silenced, there will be a demonstration of salvation, kingdom authority, kingdom power, kingdom might, and the life and the power of the Christ shall be made manifest. Yes. So I love it. Could I have the board? I could go get it, but I just, look with me. So as we're moving it over, I can do it from the floor here. Let's look at Daniel chapter 7. Okay, we're going to continue to talk about how to function in the courts of heaven. Thank you, Pastor. Daniel chapter 7, we read this last night. We're going to read verses 9 and 10. We're just really going to dig down and teach today and hopefully release some revelation so that we can begin to see what God wants to do. So I watched, it says, till thrones were put in place. And the Ancient of Days was seated. His garment was white as snow. His hair was like pure wool. His throne was a fiery flame. Its wheel a burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. A thousands ministered to him. Do you realize that we're reading about what Revelation also reveals? A thousands ministered to him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. And then it says, all that we're seeing is the court. It says the court was seated. And watch what happens next. And the books were open. Everybody say books. Now, This is really important. Obviously, whatever is going to happen in the court is connected to these books. Because it says the court is seated, the judicial system of heaven is seated, and the books are open. You see, here's the deal. What are the books? The books are anything, well, there's many different books, but the books, what I want to talk about this morning, the books are anything from our own personal destinies that we were created for, all the way up to the destinies of nations. See, Psalms 139 in verse 16 says that before my days were fashioned, or before I fulfilled any of my days, they were fashioned, and before I was alive, my substance was formed, and they were written down in your books. Do you understand that everything has been written down in the book about your days and about my days? Amen. That literally there is a book in heaven that has chronicled what you were put here for, what your kingdom purpose is. That's what's in the books. Your days yet unfashioned were written down in the books. Your substance yet unformed were written down in the books. Everything about you is written in the books. Paul speaks of this. We'll see it here in just a moment. Paul speaks of this where he talks about, let me just show you. It says 2 Timothy, what did I do with my notes? 2 Timothy, so I'll get the scripture right. 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 9, Paul says to Timothy, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given to us in Christ Jesus before time began. Notice, Paul said to Timothy something, and I'll come back to this in just a moment. He says, Timothy, before we existed, watch this, thank you, before time began. Everybody say, before time began. Before time began, purpose and grace was given to us in Christ Jesus. In other words, Timothy, we are living out presently what God declared before time began that our lives and our purpose were supposed to be. And it was written down in a book. You'll see that here in just a moment. Now, so there's books about us individually. Watch this. There's books about churches. There's books about businesses. There's books about cities. There's a book about Phoenix in heaven. There's books about the state of Arizona. There's books about the United States. There's books about Germany and South Africa. There's books about every nation. See, how do I know this? Revelation chapter 10, verses 8 through 11. John the apostle was given a book, a small book to eat. And when he had eaten this book, he did something. He said he began to prophesy to nations. Why did he prophesy to nations? Because he had eaten what was in the books of heavens about those nations. So he began to prophesy the destiny of those nations. So what's in the books individually? States, cities, nations, churches, businesses. What's in the books? What is in the books is those things' kingdom purpose. So if there is a book, it has kingdom purpose in it. In other words, the purpose of the books is to declare what you are put here for, what the city of Phoenix is here for, what the state of Arizona is here for. It's all written down in a book in heaven. Now, that doesn't mean that we're going to fulfill the kingdom purpose. It just means it's written down. It means it's what we were put here for. It means that's that the reason Phoenix existed, there's a kingdom purpose connected to it. But the reason Arizona exists, there's a kingdom purpose connected to it. It's in the books. Are you tracking with me here? So watch this. It says the court was seated and the books were open. Why is that important? Because obviously it's going to take legal action to legally get what is in the books fleshed out in the earth. Let me put you this way. Did you know that Jesus Christ himself has a book? See, the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 10 and verses 5 through 7, the scripture says that Jesus said, in the volume of the book, it has been written to me, I have come, O God, to do your will. Hebrews 10, 5 through 7, paraphrase. It has been written down in the volume of the book. He's not talking about the Bible. He said, it has been written down in a book. I have come, O God, in the volume of the book, I have come, O God, to do your will. So he said, the purpose that I came in, he said, and you didn't want sacrifice and burnt offerings. Here's what he said. You prepared for me a body. Why did you prepare for me a body? So that I would have something to function in, so that, watch this, what was written in the books of heaven about me, I could flesh out in the earth. That's why John 1:14 says, he's the Word made flesh. I'm not saying it doesn't mean other things, but I'm saying that's a part of what it means, that Jesus is the Word. What's the Word? What was written about him in the books, he has come to flesh it out into the earth. He's the Word made flesh. Well, guess what? He's our forerunner. So if we have books in heaven, which we do, what's our job? To become the Word that's written in the books of heaven about us and flesh it out into the earth. That's what we're here for. That's what, listen, that's our job individually for those things that concern us. But guess what? The ecclesia of Phoenix's job is to take what is written in the books of heaven about Phoenix and flesh it out until the kingdom of heaven is made manifest in the earth. And for the state of Arizona, for the nation of America, that's what we're here for. But guess what? How many of you know the devil doesn't want that to happen? He does not want what is in the books, that is the kingdom purpose and intent of God in the books, to become flesh in the earth. And what's he going to resist us with? He's going to resist us with legalities. That's why the courts are seated and the books are open. Because the court is about to take legal action that is going to deal with everything legally that's standing in the way of what is in the books from being fleshed out into the earth. That's you personally, that's our cities, our states, and our nations. Are you getting this? Yes. So we have to know how to go into the courts and begin to answer every accusation and every legality that the enemy is using against us. Now, to help just kind of get this in place before I move further, look with me in Luke chapter 22. Luke chapter 22, I never teach this thing the same way twice, because I don't want it to be canned. I want the Holy Spirit to breathe on it. So I just try to follow what he's saying, what he tells me to do something. Luke 22, verse 31. And the Lord said, Simon, Simon, indeed Satan has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat, but I prayed for you that your faith should not fail, and when you have returned to me, strengthen your brethren. Now, we know that scripture. We know it's where Jesus is telling Peter he's about to go through a really hard time and deny him three times and all this kind of stuff. But I want you to notice that he says something. Simon, Simon, Satan has desired or asked for you. In the King James Version, he says desired. And this will amaze you. And I promise you, just go check me out if you think I'm telling you a story. Or ask or desired. Here's what it means. Just look at, all you got to do is go look it up as Strong's Concordance. And the first thing that's going to come up is this. He has demanded you for trial. He has demanded you be put on trial. That's what it means. So Satan said, somehow or another, now watch this. When the books are open, here's what I believe. I can't necessarily verify this or back it up with scripture per se, but I think there's enough evidence to say this. When the books are open, the satanic can see into it as well. You see, when they're shut, maybe they can't see into it, but whenever they become open, maybe through our prophesying, but somehow or another satanic can see. So Satan understood the destiny and the purpose that was written in the books of heaven about Peter. He knows if I don't stop this man named Peter, he's going to do massive damage to my empire in the earth because of what's written in the books about him. So what does Satan do? He gathers information, he gathers evidence, and he builds a case against Peter. And then he says to God, I demand he to be put on trial. I demand a trial date for this man named Peter because I have, watch this, I have accusations against him that will disqualify him from getting what's in his book. That's what's going on here. You need to understand, Satan does not want you getting what's in your book. Satan does not want Phoenix getting what's in its book. He does not want Arizona getting what's in its book. Because if we get what's in our books, the kingdom of God is going to be established, and his empire, the empire of Satan, is going to experience massive damage. Are you getting this? So how is he going to stop us? By legal activity. That's why the court is seated and the books are open. Because it's going to take court activity. So he says, Jesus says to Peter, Satan has demanded you be put on trial. But the good news is, Peter, I prayed for you. And I'm not going to go into that. But he said, I prayed for you and you're going to make it through. There's going to be verdicts that are going to come out of the court that's going to allow you to process through. And here's what's going to happen, Peter. You're going to actually step into the destiny that was written in the books of heaven about you before time began. But each one of us, if we're going to get what's in our books, or as the ecclesia, we're going to get what's in the books of a city, state, or region, we're going to have to answer these accusations that the enemy is using against us to keep locked up in heaven what's written in the books so it cannot be fleshed out in the earth. Now let me just show you something. Because I feel like I need to do this for a couple of moments here. How did Satan build a case against Peter? I want you to remind you that Jesus said in John 14, verse 30, that the prince of this world had come and had found nothing in him. See, the implication is that he searched him out. How does Satan build a case against us to try to stop God from legally having a right to give us what's in our book? He searches our own personal life. He also searches our bloodline. All sorts of things. Let me explain to you this way. In Job chapter 1 and chapter 2, but especially chapter 1, it says the Elohim, the sons of God, the sons of God, Elohim, come before God. Now that doesn't mean, that means all the spirit beings were summoned to God's court in Job 1, both demonic and angelic. They were all summoned there. And it says, and Satan came among them. Why? Because he's one of them. He's one of them. So he had to come just like everybody else. So he come before God. And God looks at Satan and says, where have you been? And he said, from going to and fro, from walking back and forth. That's interesting. Okay, I'm going to come back to that. So going to and fro, walking back and forth. Okay, fast forward to Ezekiel chapter 28. That's in Job, but in Ezekiel chapter 28, before Satan fell, or before Lucifer fell and became Satan, the Bible says that Satan, or Lucifer at that time, was one of the cherubs, the covering cherubs, that walked up on the fiery stone and walked back and forth. See, what's going on here? See, in Ezekiel 28, Lucifer is operating in the courts of heaven in God's behalf. In Job chapter 1, he's still doing the same thing, walking back and forth. But now he's operating, obviously, in the demonic realm. Now go over to 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 8. What does it say? It says, your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion. He's always walking. He's always, what does that mean? That means he's gathering evidence against you. He's searching things out. He doesn't know everything. He's not omniscient. He and his demonic forces are searching things out to gather evidence. How do I know that? Because the Bible says it, number one. But in Job, God said to him, where have you been? He said, from walking back and forth, from going to and fro. Watch this. What does God then say? The very next thing that happens is God says this. Have you considered my servant Job? Now remember, they're in court in that setting. Here's what he said. Do you have evidence against Job? Is there evidence you have gathered against Job? What does he say? He says, Job only serves you because you have a hedge about him. Take the hedge away, he'll curse you to your face. Okay, so what was the accusation of Satan against Job in the courts of heaven? It wasn't his sin. It wasn't even his bloodline. It was the motives of his heart. He accused the motives of Job's heart. He said, the only reason he's serving you is because you have blessed him and fixed it where I can't touch him. But you take the hedge away, he won't serve you anymore. You know what that says to me? Lord, I don't need just to do the right thing. I need to do the right thing for the right reason. So search my heart and don't just purify my behavior, purify my motives. Because everything is exposed in the spirit realm. And Job got thrown into the situation he got thrown into. And it's really interesting. You know, I need to look it up, but there's a passage in the book of Job where it talks about there was no intercessor. There was none to stand in his behalf. See, somebody says, well, why did Job get thrown into what he got through into? Well, I don't have all the answers, but here's the one answer I do have, because the Lord actually showed me this. There was no intercessor to stand in behalf of Job to answer the accusations that were brought against him. This was in the Old Testament. See, I won't get to this tonight, but in Hebrews 12, 22-24, the Bible lists eight, and there's actually nine voices that speak in the courts of heaven. It talks about we've come to Mount Zion, the city of the living God, to innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly and firstborn, and church of the firstborn who are registered in heaven, to God the judge of all, to the spirits of just made men made perfect, to the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood that speaks better things than that of Abel. All those are legal terms there. And it is describing for us the voices that are in heaven. Every one of those things I just mentioned, none of them were in heaven in Job's day. Do you know why? Because Jesus hadn't yet died. So Jesus wasn't there as mediator. His blood was not speaking. The spirits of just men were not there because they were in paradise, not in the third heaven with God. The church wasn't in existence. The heavenly Jerusalem wasn't in existence. None of it was there because Jesus had not yet sacrificed. So when Job is being accused, there's no voices in heaven to answer for him. And as a result, when you don't have anybody to answer for you, you're in trouble if you're in court. And Job got through into this terrible situation because there were no voices to answer him. The good news is we got some voices now. Amen. If we learn how to agree with them. I'll teach you more about that tonight. But here's what I want you to get on this particular thing. So Job gets thrown into this situation. He goes through the entire process. His friends are accusing him and all these kind of things. What happens at the end of the story in Job 42? It says that when Job prayed for his friends, when Job prayed for his friends, God turned the captivity of Job and gave him double everything he had lost. Because restitution is always a result of the activities of a court. You see, one of the reasons some of us haven't come into restitution for the things we've lost is because we haven't learned how to function in the court yet. Because when Job, watch this, when Job prayed for his friends, therefore forgave them for all the bad things they had said about him, all the evil things they had spoken about him, when he prayed for them, God said, because you have forgiven them and blessed them, that gives me the legal right now to bring restitution into your life. We need to understand that unforgiveness will cause there to be legal action against us that will not allow us to come into restitution. I cannot afford unforgiveness. I have to forgive, because if I don't forgive, the enemy takes that unforgiveness, says you cannot forgive him. And even Jesus said that we don't forgive, we can't be forgiven. You cannot forgive this one. You cannot bless them. You cannot bring them into their destiny because they have aught and bitterness in their heart and they have not forgiven. And your word says if they don't forgive, they cannot be forgiven. Amen. I can't come into restitution. Are you getting this? So there was a case built against you. This is what, now go back to Peter. This is what was happening to Peter. The enemy had built a case against him, but Jesus prayed for him, stepped into the courts of heaven, answered those accusations, and secured for Peter what was written in the books of heaven about him. Okay, now, I said all that to say this. I want to talk about these books and the whole process here of the books being opened, the court being seated, and dealing with legal issues so that we can get what's in our book. Most people I meet feel frustrated because they know I was built for something more than this. Anybody in the room ever feel like that? Thank you, Lord. I know I've been blessed. Thank you for all you've done. But I was built for something more than this. So why is this not happening? Why do I have this sense of something not being fulfilled, not being completed? Because the reason you feel that is because there's something in your book that has not yet come to fruition, that has not yet been made manifest. And the reason for it is because the enemy, just like with Peter, is resisting you from getting what's in your book so that you're not able to flesh it out into the natural realm, what's been written in the books of heaven. So let me talk to you for a little bit about this whole issue of the books. Okay, to understand the books, you got to understand, number one, the counsel of God. Huh? Where is it? Okay, the counsel of God. This is counsel, okay? That's better. The counsel of God. Okay, Jeremiah 23:18 says, who has stood in the counsel of the Lord? Okay, that's really important. Who has stood in the counsel of the Lord? Let me give you a picture of the counsel of God. In Genesis 1:26, God said, let us make man in our own image. So obviously God is taking counsel with himself, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and I will show you, maybe even some others, I don't know. But in the counsel of the Lord, a decision was made. See, what happens in the council? In the council, decisions are arrived at. And these councils happen before time began. I mean, no, when God made up his mind and made the decision out of the council, by the way, the word council means to consult, to advise, a secret meeting, is exactly what you would think. See, that's what happened in the council of God. They made a decision that they were going to create a person or a thing called man. Are you with me? It was the decision that was arrived at out of the council. Let me show you another picture of this. 1 Kings 22, this one will blow your mind. It does mine, because it gives me a different perspective of things that sometimes I don't understand is actually happening in the heavenly realm. 1 Kings 22, Ahab is going to battle. Jehoshaphat, a good king, is with him. All of Ahab's prophets are prophesying, yes, go, you're going to be victorious, da, 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 da. Jehoshaphat says, you know, this doesn't sound right to me. Is there not another prophet we can consult? And Ahab said, yeah, there's another one named Micaiah, but he never prophesies good about me. And so they said, well, we're not going anywhere until he comes. So they went to get Micaiah. And as he's coming, the people that went to get him say, look, all the other prophets are saying, yes, 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 yes. Come on, be a team player. And Micaiah said, I'll only say what the Lord says. So he shows up. Ahab looks at him and says, what's your word? And he says, and Micaiah said, yeah, 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 just go do what you want to do. And he said, how many times do I have to tell you, tell me the truth? What is God really saying? So Micaiah says, okay, so look with me in verse 19. Then Micaiah said, in 1 Kings 22, then Micaiah said, therefore hear the word of the Lord. I saw the Lord sitting on his throne. Now he's describing what he saw that he's actually prophesying from. I saw the Lord sitting on his throne, and the host of heaven standing on his right hand and on his left. And the Lord said, who will persuade Ahab to go up that he may fall at Ramoth Gilead? So one spoke in this manner, and another spoke in that manner. Then a spirit came forward, stood before the Lord, and said, I will persuade him. And the Lord said to him, in what way? So he said, I will go out and be a lying spirit in the mouth of all of his prophets. And the Lord said, you shall persuade him and also prevail. Go out and do so. So Micaiah is saying, the reason these prophets are prophesying what you're hearing is because God made a decision based on a council in heaven to release a lying spirit into their mouth. Now notice, God's sitting on his throne. There's the host of heaven at the right and the left. Everything we see in Daniel and Revelation. And they're all debating on what they should do with Ahab and how they can make him fall. You would think, well, wouldn't God just do something and decide himself? No, he took counsel with all the entities around him. And all of a sudden, here comes this spirit out and says, I'll go make him fall. How are you going to do it? I'll go be a lying spirit in the mouth of his prophets. And a decision was made based on the counsel that was given that they went out and did what God said. Yes, go, you shall do so and prevail. Are you seeing that? See, there's more that goes on in heaven than we think there is. And you're going to keep that in mind when we get there tonight, because you're going to see all sorts of activity in heaven that is going on. That is all about the courts of heaven. But you got to understand this. Where everything began was in the counsel of the Lord. By the way, this is the Hebrew word sod. It just simply means counsel. It's where decisions were made. Decisions were made. Okay. Out of the council, books were written. See, the decisions made in the council were written down in books. That's where these books come from that we're reading about. Where did these books come from? Where did the books that have your days written down in them and your substance yet unfashioned, where'd they come from? There was a council about you in heaven before time began, Paul said. And there were decisions made that were then written down in books. There was a council about Phoenix in heaven before time began, before it ever existed on the map, of what its kingdom purpose would be. Guess what? The enemy has come to steal that kingdom purpose away. But it's the job of the ecclesia to discover what's in the books, which we're going to see later, and be able to deal with legalities that stop what God wrote in the books from becoming reality in the planet. But it all started with decisions made out of the council. So there are books that were written. Now, to help us understand this, Romans 8, 29 and 30. I used to read this scripture, I think, what does this mean? This means something. I know this means something. It says, whom he foreknew, he predestined. Whom he predestined, he called. Whom he called, he justified. Whom he justified, he glorified. Remember that? That's five stages. Now watch this. That's five stages to getting the decisions that were made in heaven. And that's five stages of getting what's in the books fleshed out in the earth. Okay, so watch this. What is the counsel? Whom he, watch this, foreknew. Whom he foreknew. Everything starts in the foreknowledge of God. Whom he foreknew. Where was that? This council. Where decisions were made. That all happened in the foreknowledge of God before time began. Are you with me? Whom he foreknew. You see, God made decisions out of his counsel that created, if you will, or came from the foreknowledge of God, and they were set about us, about our cities, states, regions, and nations. But then what happened? Whom he foreknew, he predestined. See, what's predestined? It's the books. It became predestined when it was written down in the book. Here it was just a decision. But when it was written down in the book, it became predestined. It became established. It was no longer just a decision. Now it's an established thing. There's going to be a person named Robert Henderson that's going to live in this span of time. And this is going to be what he's supposed to accomplish for my kingdom purposes. And it was written down in a book. At that point, it became predestined. The church has gotten all bent out of shape about predestination. Predestination just simply means it was a plan beforehand about you that was written down in a book. That's all it means. Or for a city or a state. It was written down in the book. The moment it became written down in the book, after the decision was made, it moved from foreknowing to predestination. Now watch this. You don't have to do it. And you need to understand that when we stand before the judgment seat of Christ, We will not be judged on this little sin and this little sin. We will be judged on how much of my book did I fulfill? How much of my book did I discover, and how much of it did I fulfill? And I will be measured in judgment against what was predestined for me when it was written down in a book about me. That's what I will be judged on. It will be possible for some people to have never fulfilled any of their destiny because they chose a different path. They'll still be in heaven. They'll still get to go to heaven, but they'll not have the rewards that they are to have because they didn't fulfill the predestined plan that God wrote down from the councils before time began. Does that make sense? Okay, so I want to make sure that I don't just do time on the planet. I actually accomplish something. And I don't live here for the applause of men. I live here hopefully for the approval of God. That I actually am fulfilling what has been decided, wrote down in a book that was predestined for me to accomplish things. Okay, the next thing it says is that whom he predestined, he called. Right? Okay. Called. What is that? That is when we begin to get glimpses of what's in our book. You see, these two are before time began. Before time began. We had very little of anything to do with those. Decisions made, written in a book, becomes predestined. But then I'm given a body. I'm born into the earth, just like Jesus. A body you have made for me. I'd have liked to have been about 6'3". But as it is, I was 5'10". Whatever. We won't even go there. But the bottom line, I was given a body to live in, to be able to flesh out what is written in the books of heaven about me. Okay, when I came into the earth, when you came into the earth, what happens is that we began to get glimpses. Nobody sees all their book at once. You get glimpses of what you were built for. Everybody wants to know what's in their book. We should want to know what's in our book. Amen. But and by the way, you need to understand that when prophets prophesy, when they're really prophesying, they're prophesying from the books. Amen. For instance, when Dutch Sheets and Chuck Pierce went through the 50 states and they prophesied over every state, and I've told them this, and Dutch sees it and understands it, I said, what you guys did was you simply read from the book what the destiny of that state was. A portion of it. You read from the book the destiny of that state. Now it's interesting because we were in the prayer meeting last night. I didn't know what they'd prophesied over Arizona. And I heard the Lord say this. I am cleansing the prophetic stream in Arizona. I'm taking the pollutions out and I'm going to cause a pure stream of the prophetic to flow. I asked Rob and Kay afterwards. I said, what did Dutch and Chuck prophesy? They said that Arizona was a prophetic state. So, they nailed it. Now, I don't have to affirm them, but I'm just saying, I heard the Lord say that, and I thought, why am I hearing this? And I felt like the Lord said, ask them what Arizona is. It was called a prophetic state. But for it to be a prophetic state, God is going to purify every polluted stream of the prophetic and bring a pure stream so that Arizona releases the real sound of God into the nation. On an ever-increasing, pure manner. That's a good thing. That's what's written, a portion of what's written in the books of heaven about it. But watch this. Just because it's written in the book doesn't mean it's going to happen. You're going to see this. But the next stage to it happening is you start getting glimpses of what's in the book. This is the called stage. This is where we come into the equation and we start having an awareness of what we were built for, what we were put here for. Listen, it should start causing excitement, anticipation to arrive because after all, I'm discovering divine purpose, divine destiny. You getting this? Now, let me show you something. Everybody wants to know what's in their book. We should want to know what's in their book. Look with me in Psalms chapter 40. Psalms 40. This is the scripture that Hebrews 10, 5 through 7 is taken from, where Jesus, prophesying of himself, said, "Burnt offering and sacrifice you did not want, but a body you prepared for me. I have come, O God, it is written of me in the volume of the book, I have come to do your will." Remember, I talked about that. This is where that scripture comes from in verses 6 through 8. The writer of Hebrews took this and applied it in the New Testament. So Psalms 40, verse 6 through 8, here's what it says originally. "Sacrifice and offering you did not desire. My ears you have opened. Burnt offering and sin offering you did not require. Then I said, behold, I come in the scroll or the volume of the book. It is written of me. I delight to do your will, O my God, and your law is within my heart." Okay, there's a key here. It says, in the scroll of the book it was written of me, I delight to do your will, I've come to do your will. And then it says this, and your law is within my heart. Here's the key. Whatever is in your book, God also wrote down in your heart. Because he said, it's written in the book, but it's also within my heart. Whatever is in your book, God also wrote down in your heart. Here's the deal. If you want to know what's in your book, look into your heart. Look at your desires, your longings, your passions, your interests, because those things are normally not disconnected from what's in your book and what you were put here for. Now, the problem is most of us have lived life and gone through enough stuff that sometimes we have lost the ability to dream. And because we lose the ability to dream, we lose the ability to perceive what is in our books. And we stop being able to get glimpses because our spirit man has become shut down because we're no longer able to dream and to desire and to have vision and all these kind of things. So God wants to come and breathe new life upon the embers of our heart to cause them to spring back to life so that we can dream again. I've never met a person that can't dream unless life has knocked it out of them. We have to let God empower us to dream again so that we can get glimpses, because whatever is in the book, God also wrote down in your heart. Does that make sense to you? So God has to come and heal the innermost parts of our heart and remove the skepticism, the pessimism, the unbelief, all that stuff that's attached itself to us through the process of days and time. He has to heal that, remove it out of the way, and blow up on the embers of our heart so that the ability to dream can burst forth again, so I can discover what's in my heart and in the process discover what's in the books of heaven about me. Because whatever is in the books, he also wrote down in your heart. The problem is we dismiss a lot of the dreams. In John chapter 6, Jesus, I won't turn to read it. Jesus is about to feed the 5,000 with a few fishes and loaves. He says to the disciples, "Have them sit down, we're going to feed them." And they're like, there's not enough money to buy stuff for." And it says this, to buy enough for everybody to have a little. Now, the interesting thing was when it was all said and done, every man ate as much as he wanted, and there were 12 baskets full left over. You see, the Lord isn't interested in us getting a little. He wants us completely satisfied with an abundance left over. We have to change our perspective. We're always thinking about a little. See, they had a poverty mentality. That's a poverty mentality. We're trying to figure out a way so everybody can have a little. But when Jesus gets done, everybody gets as much as they wanted. With an abundance left over. But in the process, here's what happened. It says Jesus looked at them and said, "Where are we going to get enough to feed these?" And it says this he said to test them. For he knew what he would do. I love that. And then it says this. And Andrew said, "Well, there's a kid here with 5 loaves and 2 fishes. And for just a second, something sparked in Andrew's spirit, or he wouldn't have said it. How many believe that? He wouldn't have said it. There's five loaves and two fishes. There's a kid here, he's got five. And for just a second it sparked, and then he said, oh, but what are they among so many? He dismissed a true impulse from the Spirit. In other words, at that point, he caught a glimpse, but he wasn't able to grab hold of it and dream with it. How often do we dismiss the impulses of the Spirit that God grants us, that he actually intends to do something majestic, but we dismiss the glimpse? I say, Lord, make me to have a child's heart. Yes. And I love it. Jesus said, unless you be converted and become as a little child, you won't enter the kingdom of heaven. He's not talking about getting saved necessarily, I don't think. What he's saying is, you're going to have to be converted. It takes a supernatural encounter to move us from skepticism and pessimism back into childlikeness. Some of us have lost that ability. If you've lost that ability, you'll never be able to get glimpses in this call stage. The Lord come whisper things. We could do this. Oh, but what is that? I say, Lord, put back within me a childlike spirit. Okay, so whom he foreknew, he predestined. Whom he predestined, he called. That's where glimpses come. Watch this. This is the important one. They're all important, but he justified. What is justified? It is courtroom activity. The word justified means to declare as innocent. See, what he's saying? He said, he foreknew us. He predestined. It was written down in the book. Councils were made, decisions made at the councils. He begins to call us. We start getting glimpses of it. Watch this. The devil starts to move at that point to disqualify us from what's in our books. Because he knows if we get what's in our books, we're going to do massive damages. So God says the next stage to us stepping into what he called us to is being justified, which is in courtroom. It means it's a legal implication to be justified, to be found innocent. How many know you can't be found innocent unless you have been tried for something? So we have to know how to function in the courtroom. That's what's going on in Luke 22. When Peter is being put on trial. But because Jesus prayed for him, he was justified in the courts of heaven so he could get what was in his books, that it came out of the councils of God where decisions were made. Are you getting this? So if you don't learn how, if I don't learn how to step into the court of heaven and get things in place for my life and purpose, I'll forfeit what's in my books. Because the enemy will disqualify me by bringing accusations against me that are not being answered. Remember last night, I've just started doing this. I'm learning just like everybody else how to function here, but I'm so aware that the thing the enemy is going to resist me with is legal issues. He's the accuser. He's the complainant at law. He's the prosecutor in this situation. He's giving God all the reasons why I can't have what's in my book, because he knows if I get what's in my book, I'm going to do massive damage to him. The kingdom of God is going to be established on another realm within my sphere, whatever God's given me. If I get what's in my book, if you get what's in your book, same situation. He wants to stop that. He's going to use legal action. So I have begun to discover that there are certain issues in my bloodline that I have to answer. I said this last night. Remember when they prayed, what did they do? When they prayed in the Old Testament to bring the people out of captivity, Hezekiah, Nehemiah, and others, they would repent for their sins and the sins of their fathers. It's not enough that I deal with my sins. I also have to deal with the sins of my fathers. And watch this, the iniquitous patterns that are in my life. Do you understand? Iniquity is not sin, it's the propensity to sin. See, where did you get these tendencies that you have? You got them from the sins that someone else allowed in your bloodline that created iniquitous patterns, so that the enemy has a legal right to come and tempt you with a given area, and you have a propensity towards something. Are you following this? Let me, I'll usually share it this way, and I open myself up some, and people get real quiet when I start sharing this because they get uncomfortable because I'm so brutally honest. But I remember when I was 3 and 4 years old, and I'm looking across the room, and some of you are my age or older, so you're going to remember some of this too. I remember they would have a Sears and Roebuck catalog about that thick. Anybody remember those? They would come to our house, and I'm 3, 4 years old. I mean, thick Sears and Roebuck catalog. And, you know, most kids, they get in there, find the toy section, waiting on Christmas or something. I did that too, but I did something else. I'd get that Sears and Roebuck catalog. I remember, I'm going to say 4. I'd get behind a chair in a corner. I'd find the women's underwear section. And I'm looking at the women and their underwear, and I'm 4 years old. How many of you know I didn't learn that? There was nothing going on in my home like that. I mean, but how many of you know I didn't learn that at 4 years old? That was an iniquitous pattern in my family line, and it was in me from that early stage. And I always tell people, oh, you think that's terrible? At least I wasn't looking at the men's section. But see, that was an iniquitous pattern, and it can't be anything. See, I mentioned this, I've discovered at least 4 things in my family line I used to just pray, I've got targeted on these things, and I've been answering them by the blood of Jesus. There's anger issues in my family line, and I have to deal with those anger issues, and I have to repent of it, and I have to set things in place, and so forth and so on. Let me just pause right there, because this will help you. Because I want you to get some kind of idea of this whole area of why it's important to justify. There was a couple ladies from South Africa. They were in Colorado Springs when we were living there, and we had them over at our home and all this kind of stuff. There's a prophet friend of mine from the San Antonio area that came up just to meet them and hang out with them and all that kind of stuff. And they said, we want to cleanse your bloodline. Now, this is about the 3rd time they'd done it. I said, man, what is wrong with me? You got to keep cleansing my bloodline. But how many of you know your bloodline has all sorts of, like I said, it's not a tree, it's a jungle. It's a jungle out there. I'm telling you, it's just bloodline issues all the way back to Adam and Eve. And so they want to cleanse my bloodline. So they began to lead me through it. I laid my life down and repent and repent of anything from Welton Henderson or Mary Louise Davis Henderson, which is my mother. I repent. I disown and cut off any of that all the way back to Adam and Eve and anything that's not of God and anything in the bloodline there. And so when I do that, all of a sudden a seer gift in the room, she says, I see someone in Robert's history, his ancestry, that is being burned at the stake by some Native Americans. And he is spewing out venom and cursing them as they are burning him alive. And she keeps watching, and she said, the reason they're burning him alive is because he stole their land. So I needed to repent for that. And as I'm in the process of repenting for the things that my ancestors did to the Native Americans, the prophet friend is sitting on the couch next to me, and I realize he gets up and walks off. And so we go through the process, and we get into some really deep stuff. And I'm repenting, and I'm cleansing this. I'm answering the accusations by the blood. I'm coming into justification in the courtroom so I can get what's in my book. Are you understanding this? Okay, so I'm going through this process. And so when it was all over and we're done and said amen, I look at the guy, and I said, hey, Dennis, I said, why'd you get up and leave? Now, he is a true prophet. He said, I had to. I said, why? And he said, I could feel the violence coming out of your blood. When he said that, I thought, that's why I struggled with anger in my earlier years. There was violence in my blood. from those days of my ancestry. It was something the enemy had a legal right to facilitate in me because of the sin of my fathers. But when I cut it off, the power of that thing was broken. Do you understand this? So one of the things I have to do over my family is I have to repent for anger. Another is sexual uncleanness. The only woman I've ever had sex with in my life is my wife, Mary. We've been married for 36 years. We got married at 18 years old. When we got together, we were both virgins. So we have a tremendous history together. But I have felt sexual things, pull, propensities that I've had to deal with. And I know that, and I remember my dad in the 70s. I remember him sitting down with my mom. I don't know how I knew this. And somewhere back there when he was working and off, and I remember him confessing to her that he had seen a pornographic magazine and he had looked at it. And I remember him confessing this to my mom and repenting for it. I mean, because we were a Christian family, and he repented for this. But see, what I'm saying is that is, and it's in so many family lines, by the way. I repent of that. I repent of that for myself. I repent of iniquity. I repent of it for my family line. I cut it off for my children. Does that make sense? Fear is a big issue. I have an older sister that one time they said a satellite was going to fall out of the sky. She was convinced it was going to fall on one of her kids' heads. I said, Barbara, my gosh, there's billions of people on the planet. It's not going to hit your kid. But it was paranoia. And that fear actually causes mental issues that the enemy exploits. So I have to repent for that. And an addictive behavior. My dad was, before he was born again, was a raging alcoholic. Now, I didn't know him like this. My older brothers and sisters did. But I didn't know him like that. And I remember I have a twin brother. Okay, so we were raising the same influences, same everything. And I'm prettier and smarter, but we were the same influences. Same influences and everything. And he chose one way, which was drugs and alcohol. And it was never an issue to me. And I had that same prophet friend. I was in a conference with him in Wichita, Kansas. He turned around and looked at me. He didn't know anything. He turned around and looked at me and he said, there were curses that did not get on you because you turned your heart to the Lord at such an early age. I said, you're exactly right. I said, there are other parts of my family, but I don't have a lick of a problem with them. Not even an issue. Does that make sense? But I realize it's in the family line. So I confess those things. And I'm telling you, when I confess those things, and even other things that I'll tell you about here in just a moment, when I confess those things, it's personal. The Spirit of God makes it personal, even though I personally may not be guilty of it. For instance, the first time I had my bloodline cleansed, seeking to step into this, I was in South Africa. Now, watch, I'm going to try to help you here. Speaking at a conference there, and you need to know, there's demons everywhere, and there's principalities, but when you go to Africa, there's some pretty big dudes there. And so this lady looks at me, I'm there speaking at her conference, she says, we want to cleanse your bloodline. And I said, what's wrong with my bloodline? And she said, I want to make sure you're saved. And she was joking, but she wasn't joking, because what she meant by being saved was this, watch this, when you step on that platform and you begin to bring the kingdom word of God, we don't want the devil to have a legal right to come and backlash against you. See, we don't get this. If there's issues in our bloodline that can be exploited, the enemy can have a legal right to come and backlash against us. I said, okay, I don't want that either. So, or my family. And so, because I am convinced he can't do anything he can't find a legal reason to do it because. See, he has to have a legal reason. So they began to lead me through, and same thing, kind of similar to what I said a while ago. And all of a sudden, there's this unbelievable seer gift named Katie Squires. I could tell you stories that just blow my mind. I've never met anybody in America, anyplace else, that could function prophetically like this woman. She's this little African, South African woman, innocent, just has just lived her life for God. She lives in two worlds at once. She lives in this world, but she lives in an unseen world, and she just blew my mind. So they're cleansing my bloodline, and Katie says there is, and this is what she says. She said, someone in Robert's history, in his ancestry, made a covenant. And she pulls his name out of thin blue air, made a covenant with a demonic god named Parax, P-A-R-A-X, and she spelled it. So guess what they did? They pulled out the computer and Googled demonic god Parax. Guess what comes up? There is a demonic god named Parax whose chief characteristic is to suck dry. Now what you have to understand is that Mary and I lost and were stolen from millions of dollars. I won't go into the whole story. And I kept thinking, what did I do wrong? What sin is there in me? What did I do? What lack of wisdom did I use? What did I do that I put myself and my family in this situation when we had labored for years to have a stream of income that would allow me to do whatever else God had called me to do? And then I'd moved to Colorado Springs, and I got hooked up with Dutch Sheets and Peter Wagner. And all of a sudden, I went from leading a local work into a kingdom-level ministry, if you will. And I'm not saying one's better than the other. I'm just saying I stepped into another dimension where we began to deal with, if you will, bigger issues on national scales. I didn't realize that the bigger governmental threat you become, the more the devil will search your bloodline to try to figure a way to stop you. I didn't understand that. So what happened was, he went through my bloodline, watch this, and he found an ancestor who had made a covenant with a demonic god named Parax that gave him the legal right to come suck me dry and steal from me the resources to either to try to stop me from being having a power to do what I am called to do, or if possible, to make me quit. I will not quit. So I began to repent. I repent, Father, for the covenant made with that God. I repent for the sins of my fathers. I ask you to move it. I repent for any alignment that I have ever inadvertently had. I repent for anything that I've ever allowed to be my source other than you. I repent for this. If I've ever made allegiances or alignments with anything, I repent of this. And I ask for the blood of Jesus to cleanse my sin and the sin of my fathers. And I renounce every connection to Parax. I say, he is not my God. You are. You, Lord Jesus, are my God. You, Lord Jesus, are my King. You alone are my provider. And I renounce every connection to Parax. And I'm telling you something, I felt things shift. You know what started happening? All of a sudden, the sucking stopped. Sucking dry stopped. And we've been in a process of restoration ever since that day. But I had to deal with courtroom situations and become justified and take away the legal right of the enemy so that heaven could say, I proclaim him innocent. Does that make sense? Okay, the last one. He says, in whom he justifies, he glorifies. Sometimes we think that's heaven. Okay, glorified. I use a term that Lance uses, Lance Wallenau, convergence. See, here's what you need to get. Once we walk through this, and by the way, all this is happening all the time. You never fully get out of this. You're always seeing new glimpses. I'm still seeing glimpses. Let me just say this about this called glimpse thing. I remember I don't even remember how far back, leading the work in Waco, whatever, I would always say, you know, I would really like to teach at Christ for the Nations. I just thought, and I knew that they had these 11 to 12 slots where they would bring speakers in. I was like, boy, I just really would like to do that. I just feel like I'd be so wonderful. And then less than 2 years ago, Dutch Sheets became the executive director of the school. And now I'm actually teaching at Christ for the Nations every week, a couple of classes a week. And I speak at that 11 to 12 session on a very regular basis, impacting, 800 plus students in those settings. And I'm like, that was actually in my books and I didn't know it. Seriously. And I was getting glimpses of it. And I thought it was just some kind of a wayward desire that was there. Does that make sense? It's amazing. I've seen that happen over and over and over again. And so it's like glimpses that come out of the book. Okay, so we get the courtroom thing in place, but then who he justifies, he glorifies. What does that mean? See, I think Joseph is a really good picture of this. Joseph was called, and God began to give him glimpses when he gave him dreams of his brothers bowing down before him, and his father and his mother bowing down before him, and the stars and the skies and the wheat thing and all that, and where he was bowing down to Joseph. But he didn't understand that what he was seeing, the glimpses he was getting, he didn't know what that was going to cost him. So we know he was sold into slavery, ended up at Potiphar's house, put into prison, and finally, I think it was 13 years, he became prime minister of Egypt, and he became a preserver of life. God sent him ahead to preserve life. But watch this. All the good and all the bad that happened to him served to converge together so he could step into his glorified position. So that what had actually been written about him in the books, which was he would be the preserver of life and the prime minister of Egypt, that he would not just preserve ones and twos, he would preserve literally whole nations of people, but also the nation of Israel, so that ultimately Jesus Christ could come forth from that nation. But how many know he became glorified because of a convergence of everything together that allowed him to step fully into what God had called him to do? So the glorified state is when we begin to live out in some form of fullness what is written in the books of heaven about us. Amen. Now let me give you some good news for most of you, all of you. Don't always think, number one, first of all, don't always think that what is written in the books of heaven about us means we're going to be famous. Amen. The truth of the matter is we're not. There may be some that are, but we're not going to all be famous. See, I love Susanna Wesley. She had, I don't know, how many kids she have? Like 17, that's what I was thinking, 17. And she would sit down in the middle of her floor and cover her head with her apron and pray for an hour every day. And the older kids would take care of the younger ones and all that kind of stuff. She was a mother to John and Charles Wesley, which actually brought the Great Awakening to Europe and to America. But watch this. She died thinking she was a failure. And yet she mothered those two boys. And her prayers accomplished things in the spirit realm that allowed them to have the effect. See, we don't understand. We don't understand that in our, what most people would say is our normal everyday life, we can be fulfilling what's written in the books of heaven about us. That's all God asks us to do. He don't ask us to be famous or rich or any of that kind of stuff. He asks us to simply fulfill what's written in the books about us. And that's all he asks of us. Okay, so whenever things converge together and we step into our glorified state, we're living out the purpose of God. I feel led to just share this with you, and I'll close for this morning. And then we'll go more and more into how to function here in the courtroom. But the Moravians over in Europe, in Germany, they had they had a 100-year prayer meeting. For 100 years, their prayer meeting went on, nonstop, 24 hours a day, every day for 100 years. And a lot of our houses of prayers are modeled after that. But this is the problem. They didn't just pray because they thought it was a neat thing to do and, kids would go spend whatever like at IHOP. And I'm not against it. I think it's awesome for those that are called to do that. But watch this. They prayed to keep the missionaries alive that were in foreign fields, because this is what would happen. The Moravians had such a heart for God's purpose in the earth that they would sell themselves into slavery as servants so they could be sent to foreign lands that had never heard the gospel, and from a servant's position would begin to preach the gospel. But they would sell themselves into slavery. And when they were loading themselves on the ship to go where they had been sold into slavery, they would sing this song. I lay my life down. I lay myself down. I lay my will down at your feet to win for the Lamb the rewards of his suffering, to win for the Lamb the lost, to win for the Lamb the rewards of his suffering, and take up the cross. I lay my life down. I lay myself down. And I lay my crowns down at your feet to win for the Lamb the rewards of his suffering, to win for the Lamb the lost, to win for the Lamb the rewards of his suffering, and take up the cross. You see, they were fulfilling what was written in their books. I say, Lord, let me lay my life down so that I can fulfill what's written in the books of heaven about me. Because one of the ways we silence the accuser is, the word says, by the blood of the Lamb, the word of our testimony, and by not loving our lives unto death. See, one of the reasons we don't get what's in our books is because we love the life outside of our books too much. So would you just stand with me this morning? Just focus your heart on the Lord for just a moment. And Lord, we just want to say to you, as the Moravians said years ago, that we would lay our lives down. Lord, I want to repent for all the places I have chosen my own way and chosen my own will rather than choosing what you want. Because sometimes, Lord, what's in my book requires me to lay my life down. Lord, I just want to yield to you. Could I have the keyboardist, please? I just want to yield to you, Lord. I just want to yield. Oh, she's not here. Okay, that's fine. Okay, thanks. I just want to yield to you. I just want to surrender to you. If that's your heart, just lift your hands and just say, Lord, you can have my life. And anything I've ever done, any choices I've ever made that have kept me from what's in my books, I just want to repent. I just want to lay my life down. I just want to lay my life down, Lord. Let the anointing of the Father. Lord Jesus, your word says that by grace you tasted death for every man. Lord, you have to give us the grace. You have to give me the grace, or I'll choose my own way when I should be choosing yours. Thank you, Lord. You're holy, Lord. You're holy, Lord. You're holy, Lord. Just let him just move for just a few moments. You're holy, Lord. You're holy, God. I love you. Forgive me, Lord. Wash me by the blood. Purify me. you for it, Father. I was in South Africa. It's probably been a year and a half ago. I go there pretty often, but I never asked the Lord to let me to do what I'm doing. It wasn't something I necessarily wanted to do. I didn't want to travel. I didn't want to be gone from my family. But you don't always get to do what you want to do. It's not saying I don't enjoy it. I do enjoy it. But only because His grace comes on me to do it. And I was in South Africa and went to bed one night, and in the middle, as I was sleeping, I began to dream. And in the dream, I had been sentenced to death. And they were going to electrocute me. And I myself, I was putting the electrodes on me myself. And my family was coming to me to tell me bye. My wife and my children. Because I was about to die. The interesting thing was, they didn't seem real concerned about it. It was like, yeah, bye. I thought, gee, that's real nice. But when I woke up, the Lord said, I put a grace on you to do what you do. And I'm, because you're willing to take the sentence of death into yourself, to put the electrodes on yourself, I'm going to empower you. And I'm going to put a grace on your family. I'm going to put a grace on your wife, on Mary, and I'm going to put a grace on your children and your grandchildren. And you'll miss things. You'll miss out on things. And I do miss out on things. You'll miss out on things. But if you'll lay your life down, for my sake of the gospel, I'll give you life. I said, yes, Lord, but I can only do it by your grace. Just the other day, that sounds so noble. Let me tell you something that's not so noble. I had the same friends from South Africa that at the conference in Dallas, and they said they wanted to go over to the Christ for the Nations worship night. So went over there, and it's about an hour and a half of worship with Klaus Kunz, and the worship was great. But I was really tired, and I was thinking, aren't you guys ready to go? And God, I'm at the school fairly frequently, and they just kept worshiping, and it didn't seem like they were in a hurry to go, so I was worshiping too, and all of a sudden, as we were worshiping, the Lord said to me, I heard Him clear as a bell. He said, you remember when the Jesus was sent and went to the centurion's house, and He said, only speak the word, because I'm a man under authority, and I say to one, go, and he goes, to another, come, and he comes, to another, do this, and he does it. He said, I understand that, Jesus, that my words carry weight in the spirit realm because I'm under authority. But also He was saying, Jesus, I understand that your words carry weight in the spirit realm because of your perfect surrender to your Father. And the Lord said to me, if you will deal with issues in your heart, if you will deal with every place of insubordination, if you will surrender to me, areas that you have not yet surrendered, I'll let you speak words that move things in the spirit. I said, Lord, I want to do that. I'm sorry. I'm sorry for anything I've allowed. It's the secrets of my heart. I just want to lay my life down. I just want to lay my life down. So how many of you would want to just do that today? Just say these words. Say, Father, I come to surrender myself to you. I lay my life down. I submit myself to you. I say, Holy Spirit, I give you liberty and permission to deal with me in any area, in any place that I'm not surrendered. I want what's in my book. I want it. So Lord, anything that's resisting me, anything in the spirit realm that the accuser is using to say to God that you cannot give them what's written in their books, I repent of it. I repent of it in my life and in the life of my bloodline. I say, Lord, everything that I am is surrendered to you. Everything that I am is surrendered to you. Lord, you can have it all. And I know, Lord, it's easy to say these words, but I ask you for the grace of God, for your grace, Lord, to live out these words. That there would be no place in my life that's off limits to you. Lord, I say, you can have it all. I lay my life down. I lay myself down. I lay my crowns down. I say, Lord, that you might have the reward of your suffering. And that the greatest prize of my life would be to win for you the rewards of your suffering. So Lord, even as I come to this place, I ask for new levels of anointing, of impartation, that I might live in this place. Thank you, Lord. And Father, I just release your presence over your people. I just release your presence. I release your presence. Power of the living God.
He knows if I don't stop this man named Peter, he's going to do massive damage to my empire in the earth because of what's written in the books about him. So what does Satan do? He gathers information, he gathers evidence, and he builds a case against Peter. And then he says to God, I demand he to be put on trial. I demand a trial date for this man named Peter because I have accusations against him that will disqualify him from getting what's in his book. That's what's going on here. You need to understand, Satan does not want you getting what's in your book. Satan does not want Phoenix getting what's in its book. He does not want Arizona getting what's in its book. Because if we get what's in our books, the kingdom of God is going to be established. And his empire, the empire of Satan, is going to experience massive damage. Are you getting this? So how is he going to stop us? By legal activity. That's why the court is seated and the books are open. Because it's going to take court activity. So he says, Jesus says to Peter, Satan has demanded you be put on trial. But the good news is, Peter, I prayed for you. And I'm not going to go into that. But he said, I prayed for you, and you're going to make it through. There's going to be verdicts that are going to come out of the court that's going to allow you to process through. And here's what's going to happen, Peter. You're going to actually step into the destiny that was written in the books of heaven about you before time began. But each one of us, if we're going to get what's in our books, or as the ecclesia, we're going to get what's in the books of a city, state, or region. We're going to have to answer these accusations that the enemy is using against us to keep locked up in heaven what's written in the books so it cannot be fleshed out in the earth. Now let me just show you something. Because I feel like I need to do this for a couple of moments here. How did Satan build a case against Peter? I want you to remind you that Jesus said in John 14, verse 30, that the prince of this world had come and had found nothing in him. See, the implication is that he searched him out.
How does Satan build a case against us to try to stop God from legally having a right to give us what's in our book? He searches our own personal life. He also searches our bloodline. All sorts of things. Let me explain to you this way. In Job chapter 1 and chapter 2, but especially chapter 1, it says the Elohim, the sons of God, the sons of God, Elohim, come before God. Now that doesn't mean, that means all the spirit beings were summoned to God's court in Job 1, both demonic and angelic. They were all summoned there, and it says, and Satan came among them. Why? Because he's one of them. He's one of them. So he had to come just like everybody else. So he come before God, and God looks at Satan and says, where have you been? And he said, from going to and fro, from walking back and forth. That's interesting. Okay, I'm going to come back to that. So going to and fro, walking back and forth. Okay, fast forward to Ezekiel chapter 28. That's in Job, but in Ezekiel chapter 28, before Satan fell, or before Lucifer fell and became Satan, the Bible says that Satan, or Lucifer at that time, was one of the cherubs, the covering cherubs, that walked upon the fiery stone and walked back and forth. See, what's going on here? See, in Ezekiel 28, Lucifer is operating in the courts of heaven in God's behalf. In Job chapter 1, he's still doing the same thing, walking back and forth. But now he's operating, obviously, in the demonic realm. Now go over to 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 8. What does it say? It says, your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion. He's always walking. He's always, what does that mean? That means he's gathering evidence against you. He's searching things out. He doesn't know everything. He's not omniscient. He and his demonic forces are searching things out to gather evidence. How do I know that? Because the Bible says it, number one. But in Job, God said to him, where have you been? He said, from walking back and forth, from going to and fro. Watch this. What does God then say? The very next thing that happens is God says this. Have you considered my servant Job? Now remember, they're in court in that setting. Here's what he said. Do you have evidence against Job? Is there evidence you have gathered against Job? What does he say? He says, Job only serves you because you have a hedge about him. Take the hedge away, he'll curse you to your face. Okay, so what was the accusation of Satan against Job in the courts of heaven? It wasn't his sin. It wasn't even his bloodline. It was the motives of his heart. He accused the motives of Job's heart. He said, the only reason he's serving you is because you have blessed him and fixed it where I can't touch him. But you take the hedge away, he won't serve you anymore. You know what that says to me? Lord, I don't need just to do the right thing. I need to do the right thing for the right reason. So search my heart, and don't just purify my behavior, purify my motives. Because everything is exposed in the spirit realm. And Job got thrown into the situation he got thrown into. And it's really interesting. You know, I need to look it up, but there's a passage in the book of Job where it talks about there was no intercessor. There was none to stand in his behalf. See, somebody says, well, why did Job get thrown into what he got through into? Well, I don't have all the answers, but here's the one answer I do have, because the Lord actually showed me this. There was no intercessor to stand in behalf of Job to answer the accusations that were brought against him. This was in the Old Testament. See, I won't get to this tonight, but in Hebrews 12, 22-24, the Bible lists eight, and there's actually nine voices that speak in the courts of heaven. It talks about we've come to Mount Zion, the city of the living God, to innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly and firstborn of the church of the firstborn who are registered in heaven, to God the judge of all, to the spirits of just made men made perfect, to the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood that speaks better things than that of Abel. All those are legal terms there. And it is describing for us the voices that are in heaven. Every one of those things I just mentioned, none of them were in heaven in Job's day. Do you know why? Because Jesus hadn't yet died. So Jesus wasn't there as mediator. His blood was not speaking. The spirits of just men were not there because they were in paradise, not in the third heaven with God. The church wasn't in existence. The heavenly Jerusalem wasn't in existence. None of it was there because Jesus had not yet sacrificed. So when Job is being accused, there's no voices in heaven to answer for him. And as a result, when you don't have anybody to answer for you, you're in trouble if you're in court. And Job got through into this terrible situation because there were no voices to answer him. The good news is we got some voices now. Amen. If we learn how to agree with them. I'll teach you more about that tonight. But here's what I want you to get on this particular thing. So Job gets thrown into this situation. He goes through the entire process. His friends are accusing him and all these kind of things. What happens at the end of the story in Job 42? It says that when Job prayed for his friends, God turned the captivity of Job and gave him double everything he had lost. Because restitution is always a result of the activities of a court. You see, one of the reasons some of us haven't come into restitution for the things we've lost is because we haven't learned how to function in the court yet. Because when Job, watch this, when Job prayed for his friends, therefore forgave them for all the bad things they had said about him, all the evil things they had spoken about him, when he prayed for them, God said, because you have forgiven them and blessed them, that gives me the legal right now to bring restitution into your life. We need to understand that unforgiveness will cause there to be legal action against us that will not allow us to come into restitution. I cannot afford unforgiveness. I have to forgive, because if I don't forgive, the enemy takes that unforgiveness, says you cannot forgive him. And even Jesus said that we don't forgive, we can't be forgiven. You cannot forgive this one. You cannot bless them. You cannot bring them into their destiny because they have aught and bitterness in their heart and they have not forgiven. And your word says if they don't forgive, they cannot be forgiven. Amen. I can't come into restitution. Are you getting this? So there was a case built against you. This is what, now go back to Peter. This is what was happening to Peter. The enemy had built a case against him. But Jesus prayed for him, stepped into the courts of heaven, answered those accusations, and secured for Peter what was written in the books of heaven about him. Okay, now, I said all that to say this. I want to talk about these books and the whole process here of the books being opened, the court being seated, and dealing with legal issues so that we can get what's in our book. Most people I meet feel frustrated because they know I was built for something more than this. Anybody in the room ever feel like that? I know I've been blessed. Thank you for all you've done. But I was built for something more than this. So why is this not happening? Why do I have this sense of something not being fulfilled, not being completed? Because the reason you feel that is because there's something in your book that has not yet come to fruition, that has not yet been made manifest. And the reason for it is because the enemy, just like with Peter, is resisting you from getting what's in your book so that you're not able to flesh it out into the natural realm, what's been written in the books of heaven. So let me talk to you for a little bit about this whole issue of the books. Okay, to understand the books, you got to understand, number one, the counsel of God. Huh? Where is it? Okay. The counsel of God. This is counsel. Okay. That's better. The counsel of God. Okay. Jeremiah 23:18 says, who has stood in the counsel of the Lord? Okay. That's really important. Who has stood in the counsel of the Lord? Let me give you a picture of the counsel of God. In Genesis 1:26, God said, let us make man in our own image. So obviously God is taking counsel with himself, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and I will show you, maybe even some others, I don't know. But in the counsel of the Lord, a decision was made. See, what happens in the council? In the council, decisions are arrived at. And these councils happened before time began.
I mean, no, when God made up his mind and made the decision out of the council, by the way, the word council means to consult, to advise, a secret meeting. It's exactly what you would think. See, that's what happened in the council of God. They made a decision that they were going to create a person or a thing called man. Are you with me? It was the decision that was arrived at out of the council. Let me show you another picture of this. 1 Kings 22, this one will blow your mind. It does mine, because it gives me a different perspective of some of things that sometimes I don't understand is actually happening in the heavenly realm. 1 Kings 22, Ahab is going to battle. Jehoshaphat, a good king, is with him. All of Ahab's prophets are prophesying, yes, go, you're going to be victorious, da, 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 da. Jehoshaphat says, you know, this doesn't sound right to me. Is there not another prophet we can consult? And Ahab said, yeah, there's another one named Micaiah, but he never prophesies good about me. And so they said, well, we're not going anywhere until he comes. So they went to get Micaiah. And as he's coming, the people that have went to get him say, look, all the other prophets are saying, yes, 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 yes. Come on, be a team player. And Micaiah says, I'll only say what the Lord says. So he shows up. Ahab looks at him and says, what's your word? And he says, and Micaiah said, yeah, 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 just go do what you want to do. And he said, how many times do I have to tell you, tell me the truth? What is God really saying? So Micaiah says, okay, so look with me in verse 19. Then Micaiah said, all right, thank you, bless you. You can be seated. Appreciate all you that stood up. The rest of you, I have spies looking. No. It is really great to get to be back with you again this morning. Appreciate you guys coming back. How many of you were here last night? Okay, almost everybody, maybe everybody. That's awesome. And excited about what I want to share this morning, both on a personal level, but also as importantly on a corporate level, because how many know God has an agenda in the earth? The kingdoms of this world shall become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. Amen. And the Bible says that Jesus is sitting at the right hand of the Father in Hebrews 10:13, waiting until his enemies be made his footstool. So if he's waiting, that means he has given us an assignment to work together with him and all that he has already done to actually subdue the enemies that are resisting the kingdom reign of God from coming. He's sitting at the right hand waiting. Everybody say waiting. That means that there are things that we as his ecclesia, his governmental, judicial, legislative body, there's things that we are called to do and that we must do for the purposes of the kingdom to be seen and to be done. And so it's quite an honor that the Lord has given us to work together with him. Amen. And so let me just show you a scripture here before I go into teaching. Last night we talked about the accuser and the courts of heaven and how he's a complainant at law and all these kind of things. Let me show you something of what happens when we answer the accusations in the courts. And so in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 10, when we go into the courts of heaven and we answer the accusations of the devil, and I'm springboarding off what I said last night, so if you happen to not be here, just listen carefully, maybe you'll catch up. That when we go into the courts of heaven and answer the accusations that the enemy is using to resist God's kingdom will to be done, watch what happens. Revelation 12 and verse 10, it says, then I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ have come. Watch this. For the accuser of the brethren who accused them before God day and night has been cast down. And then it says, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, the word of the testimony, and they did not love their lives unto death. But notice what happens when the accuser is cast down. When he is silenced. It says, salvation, strength, and the kingdom of God and the power of his Christ have come. That's what happens. You see, what is resisting salvation and the power of his kingdom and the power of his Christ from being made manifest? The accusations of the devil. Because the moment we answer those accusations in the court of heaven, the moment we do, there will be a manifestation and a demonstration of the kingdom. Any lack of the demonstration of the kingdom,
in our midst that we desire, that we long for, is because the enemy has a legal right to resist us, and therefore what God intends to do cannot be done because we are not granting him the legal right as judge by being a part of silencing the accuser so that his father's heart and father's passion can be made manifest. Does that make sense to you? So I love when I read that. I think when the accuser is silenced, there will be a demonstration of salvation, kingdom authority, kingdom power, kingdom might, and the life and the power of the Christ shall be made manifest. So I love it. Could I have the board? I could go get it, but I just, look with me. So as we're moving it over, I can do it from the floor here. Let's look in Daniel chapter 7. Okay, we're going to continue to talk about how to function in the courts of heaven. Thank you, Pastor. Daniel chapter 7, and we read this last night. We're going to read verses 9 and 10. We're just really going to dig down and teach today and hopefully release some revelation so that we can begin to see what God wants to do. So I watched, it says, till thrones were put in place, and the Ancient of Days was seated. His garment was white as snow. His hair was like pure wool. His throne was a fiery flame. Its wheel a burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. A thousands ministered to him. Do you realize that we're reading about what Revelation also reveals? A thousands ministered to him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. And then it says, all that we're seeing is the court. It says the court was seated. And watch what happens next. And the books were open. Everybody say books.
Books.
Now, this is really important. Obviously, whatever is going to happen in the court is connected to these books. Because it says the court is seated, the judicial system of heaven is seated, and the books are open. You see, here's the deal. What are the books? The books or anything, well, there's many different books, but the books, what I want to talk about this morning, the books are anything from our own personal destinies that we were created for all the way up to the destinies of nations. See, Psalms 139 in verse 16 says that before my days were fashioned, or before I fulfilled any of my days, they were fashioned, and before I was alive, my substance was formed, and they were written down in your books. Do you understand that everything has been written down in the book about your days and about my days? Amen. That literally there is a book in heaven that has chronicled what you were put here for, what your kingdom purpose is. That's what's in the books. Your days yet unfashioned were written down in the books. Your substance yet unformed were written down in the books. Everything about you is written in the books. Paul speaks of this. We'll see it here in just a moment. Paul speaks of this where he talks about, let me just show you. It says 2 Timothy, what did I do with my notes? 2 Timothy, so I'll get the scripture right. 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 9, Paul says to Timothy, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given to us in Christ Jesus before time began. Notice, Paul said to Timothy something, and I'll come back to this in just a moment. He says, Timothy, before we existed, watch this, thank you, before time began. Everybody say, before time began. Before time began, purpose and grace was given to us in Christ Jesus. In other words, Timothy, we are living out presently what God declared before time began that our lives and our purpose were supposed to be. And it was written down in a book. You'll see that here in just a moment. Now, so there's books about us individually. Watch this. There's books about churches. There's books about businesses. There's books about cities. There's a book about Phoenix in heaven. There's books about the state of Arizona. There's books about the United States. There's books about Germany and South Africa. There's books about every nation. See, how do I know this? Revelation chapter 10, verses 8 through 11. John the apostle was given a book, a small book to eat. And when he had eaten this book, he did something. He said he began to prophesy to nations. Why did he prophesy to nations? Because he had eaten what was in the books of heavens about those nations. So he began to prophesy the destiny of those nations.
So what's in the books individually? States, cities, nations, churches, businesses. What's in the books? What is in the books is those things' kingdom purpose. So if there is a book, it has kingdom purpose in it. In other words, the purpose of the books is to declare what you are put here for, what the city of Phoenix is here for, what the state of Arizona is here for. It's all written down in a book in heaven. Now, that doesn't mean that we're going to fulfill the kingdom purpose. It just means it's written down. It means it's what we were put here for. It means that's that the reason Phoenix existed, there's a kingdom purpose connected to it. That the reason Arizona exists, there's a kingdom purpose connected to it. It's in the books. Are you tracking with me here? So watch this. It says the court was seated and the books were open. Why is that important? Because obviously it's going to take legal action to legally get what is in the books fleshed out in the earth. Let me put you this way. Did you know that Jesus Christ himself has a book? See, the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 10 and verses 5 through 7, the scripture says that Jesus said, in the volume of the book, it has been written of me, I have come, O God, to do your will. Hebrews 10, 5 through 7, paraphrase. It has been written down in the volume of the book. He's not talking about the Bible. He said, it has been written down in a book. I have come, O God, in the volume of the book, I have come, O God, to do your will. So he said, the purpose that I came in, he said, and you didn't want sacrifice and burnt offerings. Here's what he said. You prepared for me a body. Why did you prepare for me a body? So that I would have something to function in, so that, watch this, what was written in the books of heaven about me, I could flesh out in the earth. Amen. That's why John 1:14 says, he's the Word made flesh. I'm not saying it doesn't mean other things, but I'm saying that's a part of what it means, that Jesus is the Word. What's the Word? What was written about him in the books, he has come to flesh it out into the earth. Amen. He's the Word made flesh. Well, guess what? He's our forerunner. So if we have books in heaven, which we do, what's our job? To become the Word that's written in the books of heaven about us and flesh it out into the earth. That's what we're here for. That's our job individually for those things that concern us. But guess what? The ecclesia of Phoenix's job is to take what is written in the books of heaven about Phoenix and flesh it out until the kingdom of heaven is made manifest in the earth. And for the state of Arizona, for the nation of America, that's what we're here for. But guess what? How many of you know the devil doesn't want that to happen? He does not want what is in the books, that is the kingdom purpose and intent of God in the books, to become flesh in the earth. And what's he going to resist us with? He's going to resist us with legalities. That's why the courts are seated and the books are open. Because the court is about to take legal action that is going to deal with everything legally that's standing in the way of what is in the books from being fleshed out into the earth. That's you personally, that's our cities, our states, and our nations. Are you getting this? So we have to know how to go into the courts and begin to answer every accusation and every legality that the enemy is using against us. Now, to help just kind of get this in place before I move further, look with me in Luke chapter 22. Luke chapter 22. I never teach this thing the same way twice. Because I don't want it to be canned. I want the Holy Spirit to breathe on it. So I just try to follow what he's saying when he tells me to do something. Luke 22, verse 31. And the Lord said, Simon, Simon, indeed Satan has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat. But I prayed for you that your faith should not fail. And when you are have returned to me, strengthen your brethren. Now, we know that scripture. We know it's where Jesus is telling Peter he's about to go through a really hard time and deny him three times and all this kind of stuff. But I want you to notice that he says something. Simon, Simon, Satan has desired or asked for you. In the King James Version, he says desired. And this will amaze you. And I promise you, just go check me out
If you think I'm telling you a story or ask or desired, here's what it means. Just look at, all you got to do is go look it up as Strong's Concordance. And the first thing that's going to come up is this. He has demanded you for trial. He has demanded you be put on trial. That's what it means. So Satan said, somehow or another, now watch this. When the books are open, here's what I believe. I can't necessarily verify this or back it up with scripture per se, but I think there's enough evidence to say this. When the books are open, the satanic can see into it as well. You see, when they're shut, maybe they can't see into it, but whenever they become open, maybe through our prophesying, but somehow or another, satanic can see. So Satan understood the destiny and the purpose that was written in the books of heaven about Peter. But it was paranoia. And that fear actually causes mental issues that the enemy exploits. So I have to repent for that. And an addictive behavior. My dad was, before he was born again, was a raging alcoholic. Now, I didn't know him like this. My older brothers and sisters did. But I didn't know him like that. And I remember I have a twin brother. Okay, so we were raised in the same influences, same everything. And I'm prettier and smarter, but we were the same influences. Same influences and everything. And he chose one way, which was drugs and alcohol. And it was never an issue to me. And I had that same prophet friend. I was in a conference with him in Wichita, Kansas. He turned around and looked at me. He didn't know anything. He turned around and looked at me and he said, there were curses that did not get on you because you turned your heart to the Lord at such an early age. I said, you're exactly right. I said, there are other parts of my family, but I don't have a lick of a problem with them. Not even an issue. Does that make sense? But I realize it's in the family line. So I confess those things. And I'm telling you, when I confess those things, and even other things that I'll tell you about here in just a moment, when I confess those things, it's personal. The Spirit of God makes it personal, even though I personally may not be guilty of it. For instance, the first time I had my bloodline cleansed, seeking to step into this, I was in South Africa. Now, watch, I'm going to try to help you here. I was speaking at a conference there, and you need to know, there's demons everywhere, and there's principalities, but when you go to Africa, there's some pretty big dudes there. And so this lady looks at me, I'm there speaking at a conference, she says, we want to cleanse your bloodline. And I said, what's wrong with my bloodline? And she said, I want to make sure you're saved. Now, she was joking, but she wasn't joking, because what she meant by being saved was this. Watch this. When you step on that platform and you begin to bring the kingdom word of God, we don't want the devil to have a legal right to come and backlash against you. See, we don't get this. If there's issues in our bloodline that can be exploited, the enemy can have a legal right to come and backlash against us. I said, okay, I don't want that either. So, or my family. And so, because I am convinced he can't do anything he can't find a legal reason to do it because. See, he has to have a legal reason. So they begin to lead me through, and same thing, kind of similar to what I said a while ago. And all of a sudden, there's this unbelievable seer gift named Katie Squires. I could tell you stories that just blow my mind. I've never met anybody in America, anyplace else, that could function prophetically like this woman. She's this little African, South African woman, innocent, just has just lived her life for God. She lives in two worlds at once. She lives in this world, but she lives in an unseen world, and she just blew my mind. So they're cleansing my bloodline, and Katie says there is, and this is what she says. She said, someone in Robert's history, in his ancestry, made a covenant, and she pulls his name out of thin blue air, made a covenant with a demonic god named Parax, P-A-R-A-X, and she spelled it. So guess what they did? They pulled out the computer and Googled demonic god Parax. Guess what comes up? There is a demonic god named Parax whose chief characteristic is to suck dry. Now what you have to understand is that Mary and I lost and were stolen from millions of dollars. I won't go into the whole story. And I kept thinking, what did I do wrong? What sin is there in me? What did I do? What lack of wisdom did I use? What did I do that I put myself and my family in this situation when we had labored for years to have a stream of income that would allow me to do whatever else God had called me to do? And then I'd moved to Colorado Springs, and I got hooked up with Dutch Sheets and Peter Wagner, and all of a sudden I went from leading a local work into a kingdom level ministry, if you will. And I'm not saying one's better than the other. I'm just saying I stepped into another dimension where we began to deal with, if you will, bigger issues on national scales. I didn't realize that the bigger governmental threat you become, the more the devil will search your bloodline to try to figure a way to stop you. I didn't understand that. So what happened was, he went through my bloodline, watch this, and he found an ancestor who had made a covenant with a demonic god named Parax that gave him the legal right to come suck me dry and steal from me the resources to try to stop me from having a power to do what I am called to do, or if possible, to make me quit. I will not quit. So I began to repent. I repent, Father, for the covenant made with that God. I repent for the sins of my fathers. I ask you to move it. I repent for any alignment that I have ever inadvertently had. I repent for anything that I've ever allowed to be my source other than you. I repent for this. If I've ever made allegiances or alignments with anything, I repent of this, and I ask for the blood of Jesus to cleanse my sin and the sin of my fathers. And I renounce every connection to Parax. I say, he is not my God. You are. You, Lord Jesus, are my God. You, Lord Jesus, are my King. You alone are my provider. And I renounce every connection to Parax. And I'm telling you something, I felt things shift. You know what started happening? All of a sudden, the sucking stopped. Sucking dry stopped. And we've been in a process of restoration ever since that day. But I had to deal with courtroom situations and become justified and take away the legal right of the enemy so that heaven could say, I proclaim him innocent. Does that make sense? Okay, the last one. He says, in whom he justifies, he glorifies. Sometimes we think that's heaven. Okay, glorified. I use a term that Lance uses, Lance Wallenau, convergence. See, here's what you need to get. Once we walk through this, and by the way, all this is happening all the time. You never fully get out of this. You're always seeing new glimpses. I'm still seeing glimpses. Let me just say this about this called glimpse sake. I remember I don't even remember how far back, leading the work in Waco, whatever, I would always say, you know, I would really like to teach at Christ for the Nations. I just thought I would, and I knew that they had these 11 to 12 slots where they would bring speakers in. I would think, boy, I just really would like to do that. I just feel like I'd be so wonderful. And then less than 2 years ago, Dutch Sheets became the executive director of the school, and now I'm actually teaching at Christ for the Nations every week, a couple of classes a week, and I speak at that 11 to 12 session on a very regular basis, impacting, you know, 800 plus students in those settings, and I'm like, that was actually in my books and I didn't know it. Seriously. And I was getting glimpses of it, and I thought it was just some kind of a wayward desire that was there. Does that make sense?
It's amazing. I've seen that happen over and over and over again. And so it's like glimpses that come out of the book. Okay, so we get the courtroom thing in place, but then who he justifies, he glorifies. What does that mean? See, I think Joseph is a really good picture of this. Joseph was called, and God began to give him glimpses when he gave him dreams of his brothers bowing down before him, and his father and his mother bowing down before him, and the stars and the skies and the wheat thing and all that, and where he was bowing down to Joseph. But he didn't understand that what he was seeing, the glimpses he was getting, he didn't know what that was going to cost him. So we know he was sold into slavery, ended up at Potiphar's house, put into prison, and finally, I think it was 13 years, he became prime minister of Egypt, and he became a preserver of life. God sent him ahead to preserve life. But watch this. All the good and all the bad that happened to him served to converge together so he could step into his glorified position. So that what had actually been written about him in the books, which was he would be the preserver of life and the prime minister of Egypt, that he would not just preserve ones and twos, he would preserve literally whole nations of people, but also the nation of Israel, so that ultimately Jesus Christ could come forth from that nation. But how many know he became glorified because of a convergence of everything together that allowed him to step fully into what God had called him to do? So the glorified state is when we begin to live out in some form of fullness what is written in the books of heaven about us. Amen. Now let me give you some good news for most of you, all of you. Don't always think, number one, first of all, don't always think that what is written in the books of heaven about us means we're going to be famous. Amen. The truth of the matter is we're not. There may be some that are, but we're not going to all be famous. See, I love Susanna Wesley. She had, I don't know, how many kids she have? Like 17, that's what I was thinking, 17. And she would sit down in the middle of her floor and cover her head with her apron and pray for an hour every day. And the older kids would take care of the younger ones and all that kind of stuff. She was a mother to John and Charles Wesley, which actually brought the Great Awakening to Europe and to America. But watch this. She died thinking she was a failure. And yet she mothered those two boys. And her prayers accomplished things in the spirit realm that allowed them to have the effect. See, we don't understand. We don't understand that in our, what most people would say is our normal everyday life, we can be fulfilling what's written in the books of heaven about us. That's all God asks us to do. He don't ask us to be famous or rich or any of that kind of stuff. He asks us to simply fulfill what's written in the books about us. And that's all he asks of us. Okay, so whenever things converge together and we step into our glorified state, we're living out the purpose of God. I feel led to just share this with you, and I'll close for this morning. And then we'll go more and more into how to function here in the courtroom. But the Moravians over in Europe, in Germany, they had they had a 100-year prayer meeting. For 100 years, their prayer meeting went on, nonstop, 24 hours a day, every day for 100 years. And a lot of our houses of prayers are modeled after that. But this is the problem. They didn't just pray because they thought it was a neat thing to do and, you know, kids would go spend whatever like at IHOP. And I'm not against it. I think it's awesome for those that are called to do that. But watch this. They prayed to keep the missionaries alive that were in foreign fields, because this is what would happen. The Moravians had such a heart for God's purpose in the earth that they would sell themselves into slavery as servants so they could be sent to foreign lands that had never heard the gospel, and from a servant's position would begin to preach the gospel. But they would sell themselves into slavery, and when they were loading themselves on the ship to go where they had been sold into slavery, they would sing this song. I lay my life down. I lay myself down. I lay my will down at your feet to win for the Lamb
the rewards of his suffering, to win for the Lamb the lost. To win for the Lamb the rewards of his suffering, and take up the cross.
In 1 Kings 22, then Micaiah said, therefore hear the word of the Lord. I saw the Lord sitting on his throne. Now he's describing what he saw that he's actually prophesying from. I saw the Lord sitting on his throne, and the host of heaven standing on his right hand and on his left. And the Lord said, who will persuade Ahab to go up that he may fall at Ramoth Gilead? So one spoke in this manner, and another spoke in that manner. Then a spirit came forward, stood before the Lord, and said, I will persuade him. And the Lord said to him, in what way? So he said, I will go out and be a lying spirit in the mouth of all of his prophets. And the Lord said, you shall persuade him and also prevail. Go out and do so. So Micaiah is saying, the reason these prophets are prophesying what you're hearing is because God made a decision based on a counsel in heaven to release a lying spirit into their mouth. Now notice, God's sitting on his throne. There's the host of heaven at the right and the left. Everything we see in Daniel and Revelation, but all of, and they're all debating on what they should do with Ahab and how they can make him fall. You would think, well, wouldn't God just do something and decide himself? No, he took counsel with all of the entities around him. And all of a sudden, here comes this spirit out and says, I'll go make him fall. How are you going to do it? I'll go be a lying spirit in the mouth of his prophets. And a decision was made based on the counsel that was given that they went out and did what God said. Yes, go, you shall do so and prevail. Are you seeing that? Mm-hmm. See, there's more that goes on in heaven than we think there is. Now, you're going to keep that in mind when we get there tonight, because you're going to see all sorts of activity in heaven that is going on. That is all about the courts of heaven. But you got to understand this. Where everything began was in the counsel of the Lord. By the way, this is the Hebrew word sod. It just simply means counsel. It's where decisions were made. Okay. Out of the counsel, books were written. See, the decisions made in the council were written down in books. That's where these books come from that we're reading about. Where do these books come from? Where are the books that have your days written down in them and your substance yet unfashioned? Where'd they come from? There was a council about you in heaven before time began, Paul said. And there were decisions made that were then written down in books. There was a council about Phoenix in heaven before time began, before it ever existed on the map, of what its kingdom purpose would be. Guess what? The enemy has come to steal that kingdom purpose away, but it's the job of the ecclesia to discover what's in the books, which we're going to see later, and be able to deal with legalities that stop what God wrote in the books from becoming reality in the planet. But it all started with decisions made out of the council. So there are books that were written. Now, to help us understand this, Romans 8, 29 and 30. I used to read this scripture. I think, what does this mean? This means something. I know this means something. It says, whom he foreknew, he predestined. Whom he predestined, he called. Whom he called, he justified. Whom he justified, he glorified. Remember that? That's five stages. Now watch this. That's five stages to getting the decisions that were made in heaven. And that's five stages of getting what's in the books fleshed out in the earth. Okay, so watch this. What is the counsel? Whom he, watch this, foreknew. Whom he foreknew. Everything starts in the foreknowledge of God. Whom he foreknew. Where was that? This council. Where decisions were made. That all happened in the foreknowledge of God before time began. Are you with me? Whom he foreknew. You see, God made decisions out of his counsel that created, if you will, or came from the foreknowledge of God, and they were set about us, about our cities, states, regions, and nations. But then what happened? Whom he foreknew, he predestined. See, what's predestined? It's the books. It became predestined when it was written down in the book. Here it was just a decision. But when it was written down in the book, it became predestined. It became established. It was no longer just a decision. Now it's an established thing. There's going to be a person named Robert Henderson that's going to live in this span of time, and this is going to be what he's supposed to accomplish for my kingdom purposes. And it was written down in a book. At that point, it became predestined. The church has gotten all bent out of shape about predestination. Predestination just simply means there was a plan beforehand about you that was written down in a book. That's all it means. Or for a city or a state. It was written down in the book. The moment it became written down in the book, after the decision was made, it moved from foreknowing to predestination. Now watch this. You don't have to do it. And you need to understand that when we stand before the judgment seat of Christ, we will not be judged on this little sin and this little sin. We will be judged on how much of my book did I fulfill. How much of my book did I discover, and how much of it did I fulfill? And I will be measured in judgment against what was predestined for me when it was written down in a book about me. That's what I will be judged on. It will be possible for some people to have never fulfilled any of their destiny because they chose a different path. They'll still be in heaven. They'll still get to go to heaven, but they'll not have the rewards that they are to have because they didn't fulfill the predestined plan that God wrote down from the councils before time began. Does that make sense? Okay, so I want to make sure that I don't just do time on the planet. I actually accomplish something. And I don't live here for the applause of men. I live here hopefully for the approval of God. That I actually am fulfilling what has been decided, wrote down in a book that was predestined for me to accomplish things. Okay, the next thing it says is that whom he predestined, he called. Right? Okay, called. What is that? That is when we begin to get glimpses of what's in our book. You see, these two are before time began. Before time began. We had very little of anything to do with those. Decisions made, written in a book, becomes predestined. But then I'm given a body. I'm born into the earth, just like Jesus. A body you have made for me. I'd have liked to have been about 6'3". But as it is, I was 5'10". Whatever. We won't even go there. But the bottom line, I was given a body to live in, to be able to flesh out what is written in the books of heaven about me. Okay, when I came into the earth, when you came into the earth, what happens is that we began to get glimpses. Nobody sees all their book at once. You get glimpses of what you were built for. Everybody wants to know what's in their book. We should want to know what's in our book. Amen. But and by the way, you need to understand that when prophets prophesy, when they're really prophesying, they're prophesying from the books. Amen. For instance, when Dutch Sheets and Chuck Pierce went through the 50 states and they prophesied over every state, and I've told them this, and Dutch sees it and understands it. I said, what you guys did was you simply read from the book what the destiny of that state was. A portion of it. You read from the book the destiny of that state. Now, it's interesting because we were in the prayer meeting last night. I didn't know what they'd prophesied over Arizona. And I heard the Lord say this. I am cleansing the prophetic stream in Arizona. I'm taking the pollutions out, and I'm going to cause a pure stream of the prophetic to flow. I asked Rob and Kay afterwards. I said, what did Dutch and Chuck prophesy? They said that Arizona was a prophetic state. So, they nailed it. Now, I have to affirm them, but I'm just saying, I heard the Lord say that, and I thought, why am I hearing this? And I felt like the Lord said, ask them what Arizona is. It was called a prophetic state. But for it to be a prophetic state, God is going to purify every polluted stream of the prophetic and bring a pure stream so that Arizona releases the real sound of God into the nation on an ever-increasing pure manner. That's a good thing. That's what's written, a portion of what's written in the books of heaven about it. But watch this. Just because it's written in the book doesn't mean it's going to happen. You're going to see this. But the next stage to it happening is you start getting glimpses of what's in the book. This is the cold stage. This is where we come into the equation and we start having an awareness of what we were built for, what we were put here for. Listen, it should start causing excitement, anticipation to arrive, because after all, I'm discovering divine purpose, divine destiny. You getting this? Now, let me show you something. Everybody wants to know what's in their book. We should want to know what's in their book. Look with me in Psalms chapter 40. Psalms 40. This is the scripture that Hebrews 10, 5 through 7 is taken from, where Jesus, prophesying of himself, said, burnt offering and sacrifice you did not want, but a body you prepared for me. I have come, O God, it is written of me in the volume of the book, I have come to do your will. Remember, I talked about that. This is where that scripture comes from in verses 6 through 8. The writer of Hebrews took this and applied it in the New Testament. So Psalms 40, verse 6 through 8, here's what it says originally. Sacrifice and offering you did not desire. My ears you have opened. Burnt offering and sin offering you did not require. Then I said, behold, I come in the scroll or the volume of the book. It is written of me. I delight to do your will, O my God, and your law is within my heart. Okay, there's a key here. It says, in the scroll of the book it was written of me, I delight to do your will. I've come to do your will. And then it says this, and your law is within my heart. Here's the key. Whatever is in your book, God also wrote down in your heart. Because he said, it's written in the book, but it's also within my heart. Whatever is in your book, God also wrote down in your heart. Here's the deal. If you want to know what's in your book, look into your heart. Look at your desires, your longings, your passions, your interests, because those things are normally not disconnected from what's in your book and what you were put here for. Now, the problem is most of us have lived life and gone through enough stuff that sometimes we have lost the ability to dream. And because we lose the ability to dream, we lose the ability to perceive what is in our books. And we stop being able to get glimpses because our spirit man has become shut down because we're no longer able to dream and to desire and to have vision and all these kind of things. So God wants to come and breathe new life upon the embers of our heart to cause them to spring back to life so that we can dream again. I've never met a person that can't dream unless life has knocked it out of them. We have to let God empower us to dream again so that we can get glimpses, because whatever is in the book, God also wrote down in your heart. Does that make sense to you? So God has to come and heal the innermost parts of our heart and remove the skepticism, the pessimism, the unbelief, all that stuff that's attached itself to us through the process of days and time. He has to heal that, remove it out of the way, and blow up on the embers of our heart so that the ability to dream can burst forth again, so I can discover what's in my heart and in the process discover what's in the books of heaven about me. Because whatever is in the books, he also wrote down in your heart. The problem is we dismiss a lot of the dreams. In John chapter 6, Jesus, I won't turn to read it. Jesus is about to feed the 5,000 with a few fishes and loaves. He says to the disciples, have them sit down, we're going to feed them. And they're like, there's not enough money to buy stuff. And it says this, to buy enough for everybody to have a little. Now, the interesting thing was when it was all said and done, every man ate as much as he wanted, and there were 12 baskets full left over. You see, the Lord isn't interested in us getting a little. He wants us completely satisfied with an abundance left over. We have to change our perspective. We're always thinking about a little. See, they had a poverty mentality. That's a poverty mentality. We're trying to figure out a way so everybody can have a little. But when Jesus gets done, everybody gets as much as they wanted. With an abundance left over. But in the process, here's what happened. It says Jesus looked at them and said, where are we going to get enough to feed these? And it says this he said to test them. For he knew what he would do. I love that. And then it says this. And Andrew said, well, there's a kid here with five loaves and two fishes. And for just a second, something sparked in Andrew's spirit. Or he wouldn't have said it. How many believe that? He wouldn't have said it. There's five loaves and two fishes. There's a kid here. He's got five. And for just a second, it sparked. And then he said, oh, but what are they among so many? He dismissed a true impulse from the Spirit. In other words, at that point, he caught a glimpse, but he wasn't able to grab hold of it and dream with it. How often do we dismiss the impulses of the Spirit that God grants us, that he actually intends to do something majestic, but we dismiss the glimpse? I say, Lord, make me to have a child's heart. And I love it. Jesus said, unless you be converted and become as a little child, you won't enter the kingdom of heaven. He's not talking about getting saved necessarily, I don't think. What he's saying is, you're going to have to be converted. It takes a supernatural encounter to move us from skepticism and pessimism back into childlikeness. Some of us have lost that ability. If you've lost that ability, you'll never be able to get glimpses in this call stage. The Lord come whisper things. We could do this. Oh, but what is that? I say, Lord, put back within me a childlike spirit. Okay, so whom he foreknew, he predestined. Whom he predestined, he called. That's where glimpses come. Watch this. This is the important one. They're all important, but this is it. He justified. What is justified? It is courtroom activity. The word justified means to declare as innocent. See, what he's saying? He said, he foreknew us. He predestined it, was written down in the book. Councils were made, decisions made out of councils. He begins to call us. We start getting glimpses of it. Watch this. The devil starts to move at that point to disqualify us from what's in our books. Because he knows if we get what's in our books, we're going to do massive damages. So God says the next stage to us stepping into what he called us to is being justified, which is in courtroom.
It means it's illegal. It's a legal implication to be justified, to be found innocent. How many know you can't be found innocent unless you have been tried for something? So we have to know how to function in the courtroom. That's what's going on in Luke 22. When Peter is being put on trial, but because Jesus prayed for him, he was justified in the courts of heaven so he could get what was in his books that it came out of the councils of God where decisions were made. Are you getting this? So if you don't learn how, if I don't learn how to step into the court of heaven and get things in place for my life and purpose, I'll forfeit what's in my books. Because the enemy will disqualify me by bringing accusations against me that are not being answered. Remember last night, I've just started doing this. I'm learning just like everybody else how to function here, but I'm so aware that the thing the enemy is going to resist me with is legal issues. He's the accuser. He's the complainant at law. He's the prosecutor in this situation. He's giving God all the reasons why I can't have what's in my book, because he knows if I get what's in my book, I'm going to do massive damage to him. The kingdom of God is going to be established on another realm within my sphere, whatever God's given me. If I get what's in my book, if you get what's in your book, same situation. He wants to stop that. He's going to use legal action. So I have begun to discover that there are certain issues in my bloodline that I have to answer. I said this last night. Remember when they prayed, what did they do? When they prayed in the Old Testament to bring the people out of captivity, Hezekiah, Nehemiah, and others, they would repent for their sins and the sins of their fathers. It's not enough that I deal with my sins. I also have to deal with the sins of my fathers. And watch this, the iniquitous patterns that are in my life. Do you understand? Iniquity is not sin, it's the propensity to sin. See, where did you get these tendencies that you have? You got them from the sins that someone else allowed in your bloodline that created iniquitous patterns, so that the enemy has a legal right to come and tempt you with a given area, and you have a propensity towards something. Are you following this? I usually share it this way, and I open up myself up some, and people get real quiet when I start sharing this because they get uncomfortable because I'm so brutally honest. But I remember when I was 3 and 4 years old, and I'm looking across the room, and some of you are my age or older, so you're going to remember some of this too. I remember they would have a Sears and Roebuck catalog about that thick. Anybody remember those? They would come to our house, and I'm 3, 4 years old. I mean, thick Sears and Roebuck catalog. And, you know, most kids are getting to find the toy section, waiting on Christmas or something. I did that too, but I did something else. I'd get that Sears and Roebuck catalog. I remember, I'm going to say 4. I'd get behind a chair or in a corner. I'd find the women's underwear section. And I'm looking at the women and their underwear, and I'm 4 years old. How many of you know I didn't learn that? There was nothing going on in my home like that. I mean, but how many of you know I didn't learn that at 4 years old? That was an iniquitous pattern in my family line, and it was in me from that early stage. And I always tell people, oh, you think that's terrible? At least I wasn't looking at the men's section. But see, that was an iniquitous pattern, and it can be anything. See, I mentioned this, I've discovered at least 4 things in my family line I used to just pray, but I've got targeted on these things, and I've been answering them by the blood of Jesus. There's anger issues in my family line, and I have to deal with those anger issues, and I have to repent of it, and I have to set things in place, and so forth and so on. Let me just pause right there, because this will help you. Because I want you to get some kind of idea of this whole area of why it's important to justify. There was a couple ladies from South Africa. They were in Colorado Springs when we were living there, and we had them over at our home and all this kind of stuff. There's a prophet friend of mine from the San Antonio area that came up just to meet them and hang out with them and all that kind of stuff. And they said, we want to cleanse your bloodline. Now, this is about the third time they'd done it. And I said, man, what is wrong with me? Did you got to keep cleansing my bloodline? But how many of you know your bloodline has all sorts of, like I said, it's not a tree, it's a jungle. It's a jungle out there. I'm telling you, it's just bloodline issues all the way back to Adam and Eve. And so they want to cleanse my bloodline. So they began to lead me through it. I laid my life down and repent and repent of anything from Welton Henderson or Mary Louise Davis Henderson, which is my mother. I repent. I disown and cut off any of that all the way back to Adam and Eve and anything that's not of God and anything in the bloodline there. And, da, 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 da. And so when I do that, all of a sudden a seer gift in the room, she says, I see someone in Robert's history, his ancestry, that is being burned at the stake by some Native Americans. And he is spewing out venom and cursing them as they are burning him alive. And she keeps watching, and she said, the reason they're burning him alive is because he stole their land. So I needed to repent for that. And as I'm in the process of repenting for the things that my ancestors did to the Native Americans, the prophet friend is sitting on the couch next to me, and I realize he gets up and walks off. And so we go through the process, and we get into some really deep stuff. And I'm repenting, and I'm cleansing this. I'm answering the accusations by the blood. I'm coming into justification in the courtroom so I can get what's in my book. Are you understanding this? Okay, so I'm going through this process. And so when it was all over and we're done and said amen, I look at the guy, and I said, hey, Dennis, I said, why'd you get up and leave? And he is a true prophet. He said, man, he said, I had to. I said, why? And he said, I could feel the violence coming out of your blood. When he said that, I thought, that's why I struggled with anger in my earlier years. There was violence in my blood from those days of my ancestry. It was something the enemy had a legal right to facilitate in me because of the sin of my fathers. But when I cut it off, the power of that thing was broken. Do you understand this? So one of the things I have to do over my family is I have to repent for anger. Another is sexual uncleanness. The only woman I've ever had sex with in my life is my wife, Mary. We've been married for 36 years. We got married at 18 years old. When we got together, we were both virgins. So we have a tremendous history together. But I have felt sexual things, pull, propensities that I've had to deal with. And I know that, and I remember my dad. I remember my dad in the 70s. I remember him sitting down with my mom. I don't know how I knew this. And somewhere back there when he was working it off, and I remember him confessing to her that he had seen a pornographic magazine and he had looked at it. And I remember him confessing this to my mom. And repenting for it. I mean, because we were a Christian family, and he repented for this. But see, what I'm saying is that is, and it's in so many family lines, by the way. I repent of that. I repent of that for myself. I repent of iniquity. I repent of it for my family line. I cut it off for my children. Does that make sense? Fear. Fear is a big issue. I have an older sister that one time they said a satellite was going to fall out of the sky. She was convinced it was going to fall on one of her kids' heads. I said, Barbara, my gosh, there's billions of people on the planet. It's not going to hit your kid.